A cloud kitchen operator, Craver's Canteen, is revolutionizing the local F&B scene as it takes food delivery service to another level. It's no surprise it was recognized by Forbes Asia and its 100 to watch list for 2023.
And joining us now in the studio, we have Victor Lim, co-founder and CEO of Craver's Canteen. It was also named in Forbes Asia's 30 Under 30 in retail and commerce in 2022. Yay. Victor, thank you so much for being here. Probably this would be the most difficult interview Ron and I have ever had because at 8 p.m. we're usually hungry. But your business is something that's very interesting because I have some numbers. I think Mordor Intelligence, I have no idea what it's called, Mordor. Mordor Intelligence said, the Philippines food service market is anticipated to register a compounded annual growth rate of 7.83% during 2023 to 2028. How do you feel about those numbers?
I absolutely believe it. I think that the food market here in the Philippines is, you know, growing very, very quickly in a lot of different ways, both online and offline. So no surprise to me at all, right? Despite kind of general macroeconomic challenges, this is definitely one area that we definitely expect to see a lot more customers spending a lot more, you know, of their income on.
What can you attribute that to? I mean, there are restaurants opening left and right, especially after the pandemic, people going out again. How is it still growing when I see it? I see it's crowded already.
Sure. So, you know, I think that coming out of this pandemic, there's a couple of interesting things that, you know, new behaviors that were created that I think are probably here to stay. So one of them, I think, is that people learned how to order online, right? Naturally, that's a behavior that doesn't get unlearned. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's just kind of became more of a part of a lifestyle for people, right? Mm-hmm. But I think the other part is that then, you know, increasingly we have more people going into the workforce that, you know, either don't have time to cook, don't know how to cook, or have no interest to cook, right? Mm-hmm. Compiled with the fact that, you know, we have 3 years worth of college graduates that are now going into the physical worst case for the first time, right? Yeah. Learning how to take care of themselves, right? Yeah. We have young families where both, you know, male and female are working, neither of them are the homemaker, right? And so there's still a lot of people consuming food, of course, right? Every day you need to consume food. Yeah. So the industry will keep growing, right? I guess it's a question of how it will keep growing, right? And which aspects we think that will grow faster.
Right? I think e-commerce is indeed a factor in this because it also says here there's a 22.9% increase in how people now who are ordering online instead of offline. But there seems to be an inflection point in terms of in the food service industry because people, Filipinos, like to see the face of the person they're ordering from, right? Talking to people, like the experience. But you're saying this kind of business where you're in, where it's a cloud kitchen, they'll order online, the food gets delivered. It's like a subscription service, essentially. This is going to become a big trend moving forward.
I think that it's definitely going to increase. You know, different kind of behaviors are coming out. You know, one of the things I always like to point out is that Grab Food as a business only came to the market in 2018, right? Yeah. 5 years ago. Yeah. So imagine how many things have changed between then, right? The space has evolved quite quickly. You know, I like to think we have a small part in that, right? Just generally looking at what's happening around the world and food trends that we're able to really bring back to the Philippines, right? And see how it applies there. So yeah, I mean, we definitely see online ordering continuing to grow. It's just, I guess the question is, again, in which aspect, right? So our particular gamble right now is on the meal plan side, mm-hmm. right? Because I guess the idea being that, you know, we did a poll recently talking to our customers asking, how often do you eat out at a restaurant, right? And the average number that we got was around 3 or 4, right? Within a week, 3 or 4 times within a week that they're eating out.
If you're spending 450 to 500 per meal.
And you're spending at least that much,
yeah.
right? So the question we started to ask ourselves was, well, what are they doing for the other 17, 18 meals in that week, right? Mm-hmm. Where they're not going out to a restaurant or not ordering on Grab. And then we really tried, are working now to solve that particular question, right? In terms of how we feed more people on a daily basis. Not in a way that it's treating yourself or splurging, but just on a regular basis, right? How do we make sure that people are still being fed?
And nutritious,
of course. So it's one of the big things that we take our pride on. So in fact, any meal plan that you get from us now, it'll always come included with a full detail details of all of the health macros, how many calories, how much sugar, how much fat, as well as a detailed list of all the ingredients, right? We're very transparent about the food that we produce.
I don't know if I'm comforted, but okay, I think there's a need for that because
Absolutely.
You either have a very small budget of 150 pesos for a full meal, right? Or if you want something more, you know, more specialized, like for pre-diabetics, I'm winking at my partner, or something else that's specialized, it's a bit more expensive. And so it does apply to that gray market that you were talking about earlier.
Yeah, I mean, food is unique, right, to every single person. Different people have different requirements. So of the different meal plan services that we offer today, we found that there's three particularly compelling sectors, subsectors, let's call them. So one is healthy, right? People that generally want to take care of their health better, that, you know, can diet better, whether it's athletes or people, you know, on a diet journey or a health journey, pre-diabetic. And so, you know, we want to be able to serve them restaurant quality food, right, in rotation, different products, not every single day, right? So, you know, healthy meal plan is definitely one of our bigger subsections right now, which is, of course, a bit more on the premium price point, right? And then more recently, we launched a service called Crave Daily, which is specifically targeted towards affordable daily meals, something that you can eat every day and not feel bad about it. Right?
These are for the people who don't cook, don't want to cook, and don't have time to cook.
Exactly. Sometimes
all three at once, right?
Okay, now this shift to meal plans, this wasn't the original concept you had for Cravers, right? Tell us the story of what caused the shift. And maybe the challenges in the transition to coming up with this meal plan service.
Sure. So, you know, when we started out in 2020, it was right before the pandemic, which, of course, when the pandemic hit, it was, you know, we fundamentally had to shift our mindset about a lot of different things, right? But I guess in the first couple of years of lockdown, you know, the market was Grab, was Foodpanda. You know, people were spending countless amounts of time just browsing new brands. And so for us, the innovation there was, you know, how do we put out as many brands as we can? And how do we improve operational efficiencies in the kitchens to be able to service all of these properly, right? But then I guess come last year, come 2022, pandemic was over, where you know, for offline restaurant brands, that's the best type of scenario. For us, it was kind of a different sort of challenge, right? And so I guess the mindset shift for us was, well, okay, people, again, people are still ordering, the behavior is still there, but as I'm sure you guys have also noticed, the price of everything has gone up, right?
Yeah.
Across the board, and it's really multiplied and amplified inside the F&B industry, right? So really then we tried to think about this problem of people are still eating out, people are still ordering food, it's still a huge market, it's a growing market, but you know, we needed to adapt, right, to the new world that we're living in, right, the post-pandemic market, right? So meal plans was one of our ways to tackle this problem. We also entered a lot of B2B partnerships, so we're serving, for example, the Ateneo campus, Xavier, we're about to enter a couple of other schools, Globe Tower. You know, so generally we find that, you know, the ability to produce great food from small kitchens is transmissible anywhere, right? But the question is, what are we going to do with that, right? And what's the greatest service opportunities for
us? Did you have a problem with the consumers? You have a very different set of consumers during the pandemic and now.
Absolutely. It's so, you know, in the early days of pandemic, it was kind of just, I think for a lot of brands, it was spray and shoot, right? It was, you know, put out concepts, see what works, right? See what people like, what they're gravitated towards. But now it's all about loyalty, right? You're not going to eat at a brand unless you really like that brand now, right? It's not so much about discovering new stuff or whatnot, right?
Sometimes you go back to the comfort food.
Most of the time you go back to the comfort food, right? Especially if you're only treating yourself out a couple times in a week, right? You're going to spend it on something that you know you're going to love, right? So yeah, I mean, retention has been definitely our number one focus since kind of working on the meal plans. The question that we're asking ourselves now and the number one KPI that we look at is how many times within a year do we feed our customers, right? And the target is 260 times a year, which is like an insane target, right? But just to give you an idea, on a monthly basis across our different meal plan services, the average customer within a month will order 28 meals with us, which is nearly a meal a day, right? So it's not everybody that's on the service, but the people that are on it are extremely hooked on it, right? It's a very it's tough to get started, but once you start, it's tough to stop.
How many chefs and how many cooks do you have?
we have a lot. It's a growing team. But really, this was also then where the tech piece comes into play. Uh-huh. This was our innovation, yeah. Right? Was to say, how do we continue to scale? How do we continue to offer more products, a rotational assortment of products, which is also very uncommon for F&B businesses because, you know, rotating products, how do you train your chefs on that, right? And for us, none of that would be possible without our tech-enabled systems, right? Which is what we spent the last 4 years really building, is how do we efficiently and productively run a kitchen to its maximum efficiency.
Well, kind of AI?
Yeah.
Not quite AI.
Everything's AI nowadays.
It's pretty close. It's pretty smart, right? The way I like to think about it is it receives instructions and it tells our team exactly what to do, when to do, and how much to do it, right? It tells us how many kilos of tomatoes we need to buy. It tells us, you know, what we need to do with them, how to prepare them, which is also then quite useful because then we're not so chef dependent.
Okay. Right? Quick two questions, because again, time flew by. Your inflation is still up, 500 pesos per kilo of tomato, right? But I think that's going to affect you. How are you adjusting to that? And second question is, what's your growth path like? How much do you plan to make in the next couple of 5 years, in the next 5 years maybe?
Sure. So the inflation one is a bit tougher to respond to because everyone's feeling it everywhere, right? You can really, every single ingredient in the supermarket, you can see the price go up. Mm-hmm. For us, it's this 100 times over, right? Imagine how many ingredients go into each dish. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to say that it was not without challenges, right? Of course, we had to go through a lot of adjustments. We try to do everything we can to avoid repricing because we know that customers hate that above all. Yeah. But at the same time, we also don't want to sacrifice quality, right? So, we do have an R&D team, a very capable R&D team that's constantly innovating and changing products. And when we have to, we'll change prices, right? In this particular case with Crave Daily, the price is already capped, right? 150 pesos, we're not intending to increase it any more than that. And so on our side, it's when the prices go up, we'll figure it out.
Don't change the price until Salve and I have tried.
We were trying not to look at the website, like, ooh, I don't want to see all of those photos. Growth path, how many percent are you planning to grow every single year, and how much money do you plan to make?
A lot. I think that, again, food is a universal business. We spent a lot of our time focusing on Metro Manila and how do we grow the area, but of course, the Philippines is so large. Right. So late last year, we entered our first overseas market in CDO. Just this past August, we launched our branch in Cebu. And so increasingly, we are building our presence around the Philippines, and the goal is certainly to go nationwide. Mm-hmm. We definitely want to focus on the Philippines first. We feel that there's a very exciting opportunity here, and it's one that it's a problem that we particularly are trying to crack.
Okay. Are you seeing any trend, aside from the projections, are you seeing any trend in possibly another evolution coming for the F&B sector and for Cravers?
So of course, we're kind of gambling on this meal plan thing. We think that it's, we're very excited about it, and we think that it's, inevitably, there will be more services that come up, I imagine, that are kind of following in a similar footpath, which, we would take as a compliment. it's an area that we definitely see growth potential there as well. I mean, of course, Grab is still growing. I think they're still reporting growth on a regular basis. The different delivery aggregators are growing as well. So, I mean, exactly to your point earlier, right, the industry as a whole is growing. It's just that some are growing faster than others.
Okay. Well, I hope you make good money for your investors. Thank you, Victor.
Thank you so much.
Good luck, Victor.